Well, while barely is heard a discouraging word about the TPP as the conservatives engage in compensatory damage control, one voice is sounding the alarm. The Canadian Taxpayers Federation is unhappy with what they're hearing. Vice President Scott Henning joins me live from Edmonton. Scott, you know, $4.5 billion for egg and dairy protection, $1 billion for auto parts today. Everybody's happy. What's the concern?
Well, except for the people that are going to have to pay those bills. I mean, look, the TPP is a good deal for Canada from what we've seen, and you've got to be part of this, and we're largely happy with the deal overall. However, this isn't part of the deal. I mean, it's not like Japan is requiring us to bail out our small sector of our agriculture industry or our auto parts industry. So it's taxpayers who are going to be footing that bill, and we think it's unnecessary and money that would be better left in the government coffers and in the pockets of taxpayers.
All right, to play devil's advocate, you know, these industries say they will be impacted adversely by this. That's through no fault of their own. What's wrong with making the transition a little less dramatic and painful?
Well, some will be impacted negatively, but the vast majority will be benefited by this. I mean, 90% of our agriculture exports are going to be benefited. 85% of what we manufacture in auto parts are for export. All those companies are going to be better off. They'll be able to sell their goods to more countries at a lower price without a tax, a tariff on that. They'll be creating jobs, and the small sector that doesn't export isn't benefit. I mean, that's the way that competition works. I mean, we don't go and compensate a pizza place in downtown Hamilton when another pizza place opens up next to it. I mean, that's not the way that competition works. And especially with the ag sector, I mean, some of those industries have been well protected and have a lot of government benefits as is with the supply management system.
I guess I was struck, Scott, by the fact that this had all been approved by the cabinet even before the deal was announced, this $4.3 billion for the dairy industry. It sounded like they'd already figured out they had to go this route even before the deal was signed.
Well, it's certainly a political decision. It's not not one that we think is a sound trade decision or a sound financial decision. I mean, it is one to, you know, the squeaky wheel gets the grease, and these are some of the squeakiest wheels, and they are getting the grease, particularly because we're in a campaign period.
Yeah, it's campaign grease is the most liberally applied, as you know. Any concern from your end about how the fact that supply management being kept in place does add to the cost for consumers? I mean, they do pay artificially high prices for dairy products and eggs. Is that something that you're hearing some pushback from the grassroots on?
Well, we've largely stayed out of supply management as an issue until more recently, when we started hearing a lot more from our supporters that were concerned about it. We started polling our supporters on it, and we are seeing less and less support for the supply management system that's in place. I mean, we know that consumers are already paying more than they should for a lot of those products, your milk, your poultry, your eggs. And we're, you know, especially when you live near border towns, I mean, there's a lot of people in BC that drive across the border and pick up their milk. In fact, I think there was a Costco in Washington that was, they wanted no Canadian days because there were so many Canadians down there buying up all the milk. So, I mean, Canadians do know how much it is costing them extra, and I think that I think the support for supply management is not quite as high as it once was.
Okay, Scott, thanks for joining us. Appreciate it.
Anytime.